Weeping by the mirror before the night, but joy comes with the morning. And for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be weak by your favor, O Lord. You have established me as strong as a mountain. You hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, O Lord, I cried, and to the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my death if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it tell you of your faithfulness by here, O Lord? Graciously, O Lord, be my helper. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have taken off my sackcloth and clothed me with gold, so that my soul may praise you and not be saddened. O Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever and ever. The word of the Lord. The second lesson is from Revelation chapter 5, verses 11 to 14. Then I looked, and I heard the voice from many angels surrounding the throne of the living creatures and the elders. They numbered myriads and thousands of thousands, singing with one voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing to the one seated on the throne and the Lamb, "Be blessed, honor and glory and mighty forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen," and the elders fell down and worshiped. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the
gospel. The Holy Gospel this morning is a reading from St. John, the 21st chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And after these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." And they said to him, "We will go with you." So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" And they answered him, "No." And he said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and he jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there, with fish on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. And this was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" And he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." And he said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. And after this, he said to him, "Follow me." This is the gospel of the Lord. Well, in these Sundays after Easter, which really is part of Easter, we have 6 weeks of Easter, 49 days of Easter in these weeks of following our Easter Sunday. We kind of unpack what Easter, what the resurrection means for the church, means to you and me, Christian people. And so we hear stories of the resurrection, or hear the post-resurrection appearances of Jesus after he was tried and crucified and died and was raised from the tomb. And we hear these stories through the eyes of different people who were close to Jesus. And so we try to, through their eyes, we try to recapture the meaning or the application of the hope found in this most pivotal event in all of history and certainly of Christian history for today. And yes, the cutesy little sermon title, there's an app for that. There is, and you all know what apps are, right? Those of you who have smartphones. There's an application. There is an application, there is an app for these appearances of Jesus after his resurrection. And so that's what we're trying to get at today. There is an app, there is an application for us in the Easter story. There is an application for you in the Easter story. There was an Oscar-winning documentary. It was called 20 Feet from Stardom. Not many people have heard about it, 20 Feet from Stardom. But it was an Oscar-winning documentary that was simply about backup singers. It was all about backup singers, those whose careers take place just beyond the spotlight. Hence the title of the movie, 20 Feet from Stardom. So they are on stage, standing just a few feet behind or to the side of people like Sheryl Crow or Coldplay, or we're all thinking about Merle Haggard these days, right? Bruce Springsteen, U2, James Taylor, Bette Midler, all of these famous singers. You could list your own famous singer as well. Their voices are key to the songs that we hear. Not the soloists, but the backup voices. The backup voices are key to the songs that we hear from our favorite artists. And they are songs that we love. But often we never know who the backup singers are. I mean, there they are, 20 feet from Stardom, and they seem to sing with such, I mean, they're great singers, and they sing with such joy. They know exactly what their part is, but they're not in the spotlight, are they? They're not the ones we tend to think of. We don't even know the names of backup singers. Well, I was thinking about these backup singers as I was thinking about Simon Peter. In the Bible, when you find the listing of the 12 disciples, Simon Peter is always listed first. He's always number one. Simon Peter is at the top of the list of the 12 disciples. And through the Gospels, it seems Simon Peter is the one who is within the circle of the spotlight. And when you think about it, Simon Peter is in so many ways kind of like us. Simon Peter is kind of like us, kind of like the people that we would want to be. Well, my sermon this morning is kind of a Bible study, kind of just a commentary on the Bible text, and if that doesn't appeal to you, maybe Bible studies really don't appeal to you, maybe just hearing words about the Bible, hearing a commentary on the Bible. We typically don't do this, but if that doesn't appeal to you, then I say to you, then, you know, wait till next week or wait till the next sermon comes around. But today we're going to do kind of a Bible study, and if you don't like that, you might find it easier, at least follow along in the Bibles. You know, and we have Bibles available for you. There are those black books right in the pews in front of you. So I'm just going to invite you to take out the Bible and follow along as we go through this. We're going to go through it, not verse for verse, but maybe highlight some important verses. And, you know what, if that doesn't appeal to you, take out your Bible anyway and just page through. Because, you know, I can't see what page you're on. But I'm going to invite you to turn to the text, and that's the 21st chapter of John. And it's page 101 and 102 in the New Testament, so in the back portion of your Bible in the New Testament. John chapter 21. Chapter 21. And like I say, if you don't want to do this, that's fine. It would just be kind of cool to see you all with your Bibles open, you know. The members of his or her church with their Bibles open. Pastors don't get to see that very often. So follow along with me. Chapter 21 of St. John. Remember Matthew, Mark, and then John. So we begin right with verse 1. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Galilee. Showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. Well, when did Jesus show himself to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias before this? It says that he showed himself again, or Tiberias being just another name for Galilee, the Sea of Galilee. When did Jesus show himself to the disciples at the Sea of Galilee? Well, we have to go back 3 years before this text, when Jesus called his disciples. For they were fishermen, and they were casting their nets in the Sea of Galilee. So our minds, we remember the first calling of Jesus calling his first disciples at the Sea of Galilee. But now we fast forward to after the crucifixion, right? These words were written after Jesus' death, after Jesus' resurrection. And Jesus and Simon Peter and six other disciples have gone back there. They've gone back to Tiberias. They've gone back to Galilee. Peter has gone back to his old neighborhood, right? He's gone back, really we might say that he's gone back to the beginning, back to the Sea of Galilee, 60 miles north of Jerusalem, and the site of the resurrection. That's where they're at. They're at the site where Jesus was resurrected, back to where Jesus called Peter, and Galilee, the place where Jesus did most of his teaching. Peter doesn't know what to do with himself, really, after the resurrection, so he just decides to go fishing. Got nothing else to do? Why don't you go fishing? So Peter goes back to his old career of being a fisherman. And the other six say, verse 3 now, the other six say, if you're going fishing, then we'll go with you, right? Verse 3. We'll go with you. Remember, Peter is a leader. He is a leader, and he's the kind of person that people want to follow. He's the kind of person that people look for direction from and answers from. So they say, we're going to follow you, Peter. We'll go fishing with you. And they go out. And they fish all night, and they catch... How much did you find out how much they caught the first time? They fish all night. They don't catch any fish, right? They catch nothing. And the timid light is really warning a stranger. Now we're at verse 4. Just after daybreak, the sun was just coming up. Just after daybreak, they've been out fishing all night. They've caught nothing. Verse 4, there is a stranger. We know it's Jesus. John tells us tells you and me that it's Jesus, but the disciples don't know. The disciples think it's a stranger. And he stands on the shore and he shouts out to the disciples, "Children, you have no fish, do you?" Which, that's what you want to hear, I'm sure, as a fisherman after you've been fishing all night. No, Captain Obvious here. You have no fish. And they explain to this stranger that they've been fishing all night and no, they don't have any fish. And the stranger tells them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat. Cast your net on the other side of the boat." Verse 6. You see that in verse 6? And suddenly, the nets are full. Suddenly the nets are bursting. And Peter sees this large catch of fish and he realizes that this is a windfall. That this is really a statement of abundance. And perhaps Peter remembers the time when he gathered with Jesus and Jesus blessed bread and fish and gave it to others to eat. So that Jesus fed 5,000 people when there were only 5 loaves and 2 fish. Perhaps Peter was thinking of this great miracle that Jesus performed. And so Peter gets dressed, verse 7. Let's go there. Peter gets dressed in verse 7, and he jumps in the water. You gotta love that, right? Peter's naked, John tells us. He's fishing all night with very little, probably no clothes on, according to John. And after this great abundance of fish, after they follow Jesus' commands, he gets dressed, and he dives into the Sea of Galilee. Seems like a strange thing to do. You'd think you would take off your clothes, right, to jump in the water. Not Peter. He gets dressed, and he jumps in the water, and he makes his way towards shore. And the others follow in the boat. Jesus, or Peter, in this miracle of Jesus, gets dressed. It's almost as if he gets dressed to go to a party. He's got to get some place. And they get to shore, and Jesus serves them a breakfast of fish and bread cooked over a charcoal fire. We're in verse 13 right now. Jesus feeds the disciples, and this is kind of reminiscent of communion. The meal is a communion meal of fish and of bread. Jesus breaks it and he gives it to his disciples. It is a gift. It is a sign of grace. This meal is a sign that they are loved. Offered to them by the one who knows them best, insists on loving them, and his body still bears the wounds of the Romans, the spear and the Roman nails that pierced this Jesus. Jesus knows these disciples, and he gives them this gift of meal, this gift of grace, this gift of love. He knows them. And I think we all kind of have this fear, don't we? We all have this fear if people really know us. If people really know who we are, it would be hard for them to accept us. If people really knew who I was as a person and my selfish thoughts and the error of my ways, nobody would accept me, let alone love me. And then we think about the church. You know, we think about this church and coming here to this place. If they really knew how much we screwed up, they wouldn't let us in the doors here at the church. I mean, sometimes we think this way. If people really knew how selfish we are, they wouldn't let us in. And if God knows us, really knows us, I mean, that's kind of scary to think that God knows us, all of our faults, all of our frailties. That's super scary. So we nurse this fear that we really don't have any business being here or being found in the grace and the love of this God. But you know what? That's what Peter's story is for. That's why we have this story of Peter. Peter is this passionate disciple. He's one of Jesus' first followers. He's a regular guy, hardworking. He's physical. Doesn't always think before acting. You know, and he does some major screwing up in his life. Peter gets set straight more times than any other disciple, and this is clear throughout all of Scripture. Jesus is the confident one. Jesus is the courageous one, the faithful one, the loyal one, the one who is such a leader and so bright and so sure that he sees everything clearly, but oftentimes he misses it totally. And despite all of this, you see, despite all of this, he is still loved by this Jesus. He is still called by this Jesus to be a leader. He is still forgiven by this Jesus. You'd think a love like that would change someone immediately, but Peter really never does change. He never really changes. You would think that a love like that would just, bam, would just change somebody. But you see, a love like this, it takes a long time for it to go to work. A long time for this love to complete its work. So the question is, the application for us is, what happens to us? What happens to you? You who are so bright, you who are so courageous, you who are a leader, you who are so faithful and curious and honest, you who think that most of the time you are so right. What happens when you fail? What happens when you look at yourself in the mirror like Peter had to look himself in the mirror and you realize that you don't know this person that's staring back at you? What happens to you? What happens to your real life when you realize that you weren't so bright, that you weren't so courageous, you weren't so selfless? You thought you were so open to new truth. You thought that you were so bright, but in fact, you missed it. You missed what you should have never missed. What does a moment like that do to you? What does it do to a soul? What does it do to a life? What happens to us when we, in our failure, also discover that Jesus continues to love us, that Jesus continues to forgive us? What happens to us? We become more loving, don't we? We become more forgiving. That's what happens. We become the very things, the very gifts that Jesus gives us. We become more loving, we become more forgiving. Because that's how this moment changes us. That's how, in verse 19, the very end of the story, this is how we follow him. This is how we follow this Jesus. This is how you tend to the sheep. This is how you feed Jesus' sheep. Verse 15 and 16 and 17. We live our lives mostly judging others, comparing them to some standard that we have made up, and they just haven't quite measured up to that standard. But now, when you fail and you've been loved by Jesus, you change, you see. Grace changes you. Grace softens you. Grace makes you kinder. Grace gives you the gift of mercy. That's what the love and forgiveness of Jesus does to us. And so when you and I, when we look at others, we remember the same love and the same forgiveness that Jesus has given us. We remember that we're loved. We remember that we're forgiven. And so we in turn love and forgive. You see, this changes how we see ourselves. And it changes how we see others. And then, you know what we remember? We remember that we're just backup singers. We are just backup singers. We're not in the spotlight. But when we show, when we demonstrate Jesus' love and forgiveness, the spotlight isn't on us, but the spotlight is on this God who calls us in this this Jesus who stands just feet away.